peaceful eyes. Cellophane flowers of yellow and green towering over our heads.
We have had, as you know, a few talks looking at cognitive issues in aging, and I am extremely pleased that Dr. Charles Bowden, who is a professor of psychiatry and who also holds the Nancy U. Karen and Research Chair of Psychiatry in that department, has been able to come and speak with us, because he has a lot of insights, a tremendous amount of knowledge, a lot of research to back up what he knows, and can answer, I believe, a lot of the questions that perhaps the other talks have left you with in the back of your mind dealing with the patients that you have who have cognitive problems. Okay, thank you.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. I hope that this is a program, and it's a very intensive program, that's been helpful to all of you with your diverse backgrounds. The presentation that I have, has what appears to be a simple talk, it's hard to talk about it without making it complex, because it has something to do with the complexity of the subject. Even if we simply talk about mood disorders in terms of the nomenclature that psychiatrists and other clinical practitioners use, you see that it's fairly complex. We have mood disorders here in yellow, and then there are some that are based on etiology. A few that are based on etiologies, generally substance-induced or secondary to general medical conditions, a point that I'll come back to in relationship to a just published series of articles this month that's actually received national general press attention. And then what are called idiopathic, which simply in this instance means that we don't fully know, but we have actually indications in many instances what the specific etiologies are. And they're divided into depressive disorders and bipolar disorders. And bipolar disorders are also depressive, but they also involve mania. And then there's a sort of chronic low level, there's a severe episodic but infrequent type of depression. And then a kind of strange approach, but with some justification, I think, psychiatric disorders have this NOS, not otherwise specified. So rather than assume that we can be exact about some of these subdivisions syndromally, if there's room for some lack of clarity, but we know that it's a clinically significant condition, this suffix gets attached to it. And then the bipolar disorders are divided again into ones with some point in time, full manic episode, mild manic symptoms, and then again this general group. So even the lay of the land syndromally is not very simple. Well, there's some problems with this. It really doesn't reflect the way that these play out. It tends to be only categorical, and although we think dimensionally or in terms of symptom constructs, that doesn't get factored into the grid that I just showed you. And it's also based on full mood episodes. What we've learned is that people, even if they don't meet full symptoms, can have significantly impairing symptoms. I think that this is true in almost all chronic conditions. If one looks, for example, at diabetes, patients are not in necessarily full or life-threatening syndromes at a point in time, but yet the level of the symptoms, and sometimes it's not even symptoms, sometimes it's just only what's identifiable as a result of laboratory assessments, is clinically significant. And even the symptom definitions are not very comprehensive. Some things, psychosis, mild levels of normal thinking, severe levels of irritability, and are not in the DSM definitions. And although this results in underdiagnosis of some conditions, it also results in overdiagnosis of depression, in that depression is defined to indicate too much waiting on disappointments, things like that. So a person who gets a C in a class that they'd hope to get an A in, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but not much, can end up with a diagnosis. Some of you are psychologists, and some of you have had courses about this and will have some sense about this. They can end up with a diagnosis rather than misses the evidence, in fact, overstates the evidence. And they tend to require too long a period of episodes. This is especially a problem in bipolar disorder, and especially not in aging, which we're principally focusing on in this presentation. But in bipolar disorder in kids, where if you read the text, this diagnostic and statistical manual, it says, well, these things have to, depressions have to last a full week, manic episodes have to last a full week. But the kids with bipolar disorder don't know this, and so they have episodes that last a day, 2 hours, even an hour. And those are still clinically significant, and yet that's not factored in to the official nomenclature. Well, what about the relationship of this to aging, which is the overall umbrella focus of series of lectures? Well, some of this you've seen, but there are a lot of people over the age of 65, and they constitute well over 10% of the U.S. population, and they get broken down into the old, even I fit into this category at this point in my life, the very old, and then when we get above 80, the pieces of pie get smaller, but as you're aware, this portion of the age brackets will increase disproportionately in most developed societies over this over the rest of this century, certainly. And the disorders that I'm talking about have, to some degree, changed presentations in the elderly, but in the main, they're disorders that maintain the same severity. No patient matures out of a major depressive disorder. No patient matures out of a bipolar disorder. So the ways in which aging principally affects it has to do with the added consequences of other impairments that are associated with aging. And there is some relationship of where patients, where the elderly are located in relationship to some of the points that I'm talking about. A lot of it has to do with the complexity of medication regimens for general medical and psychiatric conditions. So only a small proportion of elderly are in nursing homes, and a small proportion are in lower level of care facilities. There's a substantial number of individuals who live in their homes but have some degree of supports. The more people are unable to come into doctors and psychologists and clinic settings, the more likely they are to have really complex regimens that are poorly coordinated. So you're really not sure who the last person to show up in the nursing home was and write an order. Simply getting them into the clinical setting becomes an issue in its own right. The linkage comorbidly with general medical conditions is really serious. this is, I didn't pick this just in a random sense. It's been one of the most intensively studied, and it's a bi-directional causal kind of issue. That if we look at the high correlation, increased prevalence of depression in people with cardiovascular disease, increased presence of cardiovascular disease in people with depression, depression clearly is a complicating factor in the management and the outcomes of cardiovascular disease. It's associated with increased cost and increased mortality. And although probably bipolar disorder, which is sort of associated with greater increases in mortality from all causes, suicide, but also cardiovascular deaths, has been the least studied. The reasons for that have in part to do with impacts of the diseases on clotting times and on beat-to-beat variability and heart rates. So it has to do with interactions of the brain with the autonomic system peripherally and with clotting systems. But there are also effects of cardiovascular treatments on mood states and similarly treatments for depression on cardiovascular conditions, in part because many treatments that are used for psychiatric conditions affect the parallel pathways involving autonomic neurotransmitters in the brain, and those are also the foci of many treatments for cardiovascular diseases when the so-called sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system are acted on by treatments used for hypertension and other cardiovascular diseases. Whoops, let me go back to this. Well, what are the problems in the mood disorders in the elderly? Well, in addition to disability and higher rates of functional decline and quality of life and mortality, it also has a lot to do with demands on caregivers. I saw a patient yesterday from Laredo whose mother is 94. Well, part of the problem is with this woman, of course, is her bipolar disorder for which she receives treatment with me, but also the burden of caring for a mother who's still living four blocks away in a medium-sized town is substantial. And she's facing the issue, and at least her mother is partially agreeable to this, needing someone to reduce the burden that falls mainly on her shoulders compared to other friends and family for this. In some ways, for 94, still well, but when you're 94, you're going to have some substantial medical conditions. In assisted living conditions, one of the real problems, again, is this high number of medications. And the specific medications are going to vary, but you're likely to have some drugs for renal, some drugs for lipid, some drugs for brain-based, some drugs for GI-based conditions. And you have almost certainly drug-drug interactions, pharmacokinetic interactions, pharmacodynamic interactions. And 20% are on more than 8 medications per day. Doctors and other healthcare clinic settings spend a lot of their time sorting through, when patients come in for treatment, these bags of pills that patients bring in. And if you're only getting paid for a 15-minute visit, and it takes you 10 minutes really to sort through what the patient is taking and hasn't, it's not that they're trying to keep the information from you or necessarily be out of compliance with treatment, but simply the complexity of it all makes it very difficult. It places, I think, a great responsibility on the treatment team. One of the groups of medications that are used to treat depression, especially bipolar disorder, medications generally, in most instances, initially approved by the FDA for treatment of epilepsy. Well, if you look at nursing home residents, 1 in 10 nursing home residents is taking an anticonvulsant medication. But they're used for all sorts of conditions. They're used for epilepsy, they're used for bipolar depression, they're used for mania. They're simply used in a symptom-based, again, rather than a syndromal-based effort to reduce anxiety, especially to reduce irritability, agitation, the kinds of behaviors that are most difficult for nursing homes to manage. It's easier to manage a patient who's not sure whether this is June or September than it is to manage a person who gets angry with the person in the room next to him and slugs him or something like that, or slugs one of the staff persons. And they're used to address issues of cognitive impairment. The bipolar elderly is important, I think, in terms of differential diagnosis, because their cognitive impairments in bipolar disorder, and we can misdiagnose a patient as having dementia set out on a course that will be ineffective and in fact could worsen the presentation and the course of the individual. This could lead to early or unnecessary nursing home placement, greater disability, or failure to get a person out of a disabled state. And since the treatments for dementia wouldn't address necessarily the depression, which is the focus principally of this presentation, worsen that. And similarly, if the patient actually has dementia, but it's treated as if it were depression or bipolar disorder, some of the treatments for dementia can worsen some of the symptoms of bipolar disorder, especially in terms of destabilizing mood and increasing the frequency of shifts from depression to mania to agitation to irritability. The prevalence and incidence of mania in the elderly is certainly it's high, somewhat higher than we would see in younger adults, but rates are pretty high in younger adults too. So these may seem terribly high, but even rates in adults would be in the 2 to 5%, depending upon the threshold of definition of clinical severity in the setting. Obviously, I think one of the problems with all survey data about prevalence and incidence of disorders in the elderly is that too many of these tend to come from institutional settings, and almost by definition, the patient who makes it into an institutional setting and is part of a sample just on that basis is going to be among the most severely ill, whether we're talking about bipolar disorder, major depression, or just other general medical disorders. The diagnosis then is complicated by this comorbidity: dementia, delirium, depression, bipolar disorder. The study that I alluded to earlier, there was a study published about 10 years ago by Ron Kessler, K-E-S-S-L-E-R. A new update on that was published just this week, and it's been carried, it's in the Express, it's in the New York Times, in the Wall Street Journal. It's sort of big news. It's about the prevalence and incidence of not all, but major mood disorders and anxiety disorders in the U.S. population. And it's in the June issue of the Archives of General Psychiatry. There's not just one article, there's actually a series. And I think the reason that it's gotten so much attention is that it has public health consequences. Although the central focus is just on prevalence and incidence, there are presentations in there having to do with the age distribution, so they're specifically relevant to the focus of your week-long seminar. There are also presentations in there having to do with the comorbidity of these psychiatric conditions with other psychiatric conditions, and then with general medical conditions. And depression has the second highest comorbidity of any emotional condition, both with other psychiatric disorders and with general medical disorders. And bipolar disorder has far and away the highest. It's rare to see a person with bipolar disorder who doesn't have more than one general medical and more than one other, at least lifetime, psychiatric condition. Now, some of these may seem not particularly relevant to this symposium, but for example, if you were to look at the cross-section of bipolar disorder as it presents in youth, you'd find about a third of those people not just meeting diagnostic criteria for ADHD, but needing treatment and benefiting from it for the second condition. So it's a complex but very interesting, I think, public health area that we have remarkably good data as a basis to guide us for the part of it that we may end up working in. Now, pharmaceutical care in the elderly is a problem. That I mentioned the 94-year-old lady because I really don't know that much about her general medical conditions, but independent of diagnosis, at that point a person starts to have what referred to as the frail elderly. Dr. Geriatric was speaking about her. This has been one of the foci of her treatments. Here's a geriatric internist focusing on the elderly, but her main interest in her research has been on this group called the frail elderly. Not a disease per se, but just the reduced ability to resist, to have resilience against both external environmental factors and diseases as they progress through aging. This creates problems that we try to deal with by regulations in the way medications are handled in nursing facilities. But there's really not very much information on drug use in the frail elderly. In part because they're not easy to study. You have to go to them, they're not going to come to you as an investigator. I won't talk very much about specific treatments, but I will say a little bit about some. For example, in elderly patients where bipolar disorder, as we said, is relatively common, and also bipolar symptoms, independent of whether they meet full criteria for bipolar disorder, irritability, agitation, or foci of symptoms, so that the so-called mood stabilizing medications get used in those conditions. Well, the most commonly used mood stabilizing medications are divalproex or valproic acid, lithium, and carbamazepine. Now, of the three, certainly compared to carbamazepine, there are fewer side effects. There's a much reduced risk of drug interactions. The advantages side effect wise also hold in comparison to lithium, and they hold in comparison to so-called atypical antipsychotics. Almost any drug that gets into the central nervous system can, at some level, even if it's activating at low doses or based on neurotransmitter interactions, at some level you're likely to have some sedation with these drugs. And then these are medications that, these are side effects that are moderately common with divalproex. Now, some of these are not really surprising, but you, all the ones that I'm showing here all are could be confused with physical or general medical complaints in all instances, and in some instances show up only in terms of laboratory testing. But if platelet counts and the hematopoietic activity of individuals become less vigorous with age, and you add a medication which is going to reduce the formation of white blood cells and reduce the formation of platelets, you can see that age interacts to some degree even with these drug effects, here divalprolax, that might be adequately tolerated by the person at the age of 50 or the age of 40. This is just a list of beyond serotonin reuptake inhibitors, the Paxils and the Prozacs of the world. There are a number of other medications that are used to treat depression, whether it's treatment resistance or not. So you can see that simply to be knowledgeable about all of these requires a substantial amount of pretty detailed knowledge. This is a drug that acts on dopamine. There are also a group of dopamine agonists. Many of these were developed really for treatments of Parkinson's disease, which involves, at some level, reduced dopamine in certain brain areas. But these same systems also are beneficial in depression. So we find a lot of cross-use in depression of medications developed for other reasons, and similarly of antidepressants for conditions that certainly are not depression per se. Anxiety, phobic symptoms, compulsive symptoms, even some urinary incontinence symptoms, we find use of some antidepressants. In elderly patients in particular, we will see estrogen used increasingly, both for some aspects of depression, but also for reasons of bone density and for reasons of sexual responsiveness. There are studies and I think evidence for, in women, some benefits of low-dose testosterone as well. Some stimulant-type medications also get used in treatment of depression. Some that are intended for other purposes having to do with cognition, and some just stimulants, medications that might principally be used for conditions such as attention deficit disorder. Sexual hormones are not the only hormones that interact with mood disorders. Thyroid hormone is used. Usually this group of medications here will not be used individually as monotherapy, but in combinations or adjuncts. There's no reason to think that low levels of thyroid activity per se are the cause of bipolar disorder or the cause of depression. But across the age spectrum, and especially from age 50 on, you're likely to see some signs of low thyroid function. And even if you have a regimen that works otherwise, if you don't address the thyroid function, you're going to have a less satisfactory outcome than if you address it. And usually this is not just a one-time use of T3 or T4 affecting drugs for a month or so, but lifelong use and adjustment of those. It gets complex when you look at the laboratory measures on these. There are about a half a dozen different ways that we can assess the adequacy of thyroid function. Probably the two most useful ones are free thyroid index and TSH. And if patients have low free thyroid index, they are harder to treat with depression than if they have normal free thyroid index. If they have a normal free thyroid index but still have indications from the TSH test of below par thyroid function, those patients also have impaired function.
So I mentioned thyroid in part because it's common, but also because it's one area that we have effective and generally well-tolerated medications that can be readily added to other treatments for depression. And especially in the elderly, these become useful adjuncts. Phototherapy, that's increasing the equivalent of sunlight. And there is a kind of seasonal component to mood disorders with increased rates of depression, severity of depression, as the photo period, the amount of sunlight that we receive, starts to recede. So we're in the part of the year now where depression, especially the higher you move up in latitude, or the farther down you move in latitude, if you're in the southern hemispheres, the more this effect is noted. But you find it noted even in places such as Texas, which is sort of in the middle between the poles and the equator. Again, for most of these treatments, I don't have time to go into this, but depression in particular does benefit from structured psychotherapies. Generally, these are not in the forms of open-ended, highly frequent psychotherapy, but more psychoeducation. Think of this as very analogous to what goes on in chronic disease management across the board. The patient with an illness that he or she is going to have to live with the rest of his or her life needs to understand about what kind of factors. For depression, it has to do with sleep, what kind of drugs we put in our body, how much exercise we get, interactions with hormonal systems, that all of these things are addressable, and even addressable, as I look at the results, in a cost-effective way. Some of these can be manualized so that they don't necessarily require a psychiatrist or a PhD psychologist. In many instances, the studies have actually been conducted with persons with a master's degree in psychology, things like that. So they become feasible within a cost structure of a reasonably affluent country. This issue of comorbidity, one of the most interesting ones is if we look at migraine. Now, this is not particularly age related, but it's certainly not absent in the elderly. Migraine, many of these comorbidities are explainable in part because of overlapping symptoms. For example, bipolar disorder and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder can both have levels of increased motor activity. But there's nothing about migraine that in any way overlaps with the symptoms of depression or with the symptoms of mania or hypomania. Nevertheless, this has been a remarkably consistent a bit of data that if we look at the prevalence of migraine in a variety of psychiatric disorders, if we start with persons with migraine compared to those without migraine, you see about a threefold increase of major depression. If we look at the same thing for bipolar disorder, you see over a sixfold increase, and especially so-called classical migraine, where patients will have aura. Aura means that before the headache starts or associated with it, the person will have visual phenomena, a kind of hallucinatory experience. Maybe they'll see sort of flashing bits of lights. Maybe they'll have odd tastes, things like that. But again, altered electrical and chemical brain activity that's still not understood. Bipolar disorder and major depression are associated with anxiety. One of the problems here is we may think that we're only dealing with anxiety when we should be using the treatments that are useful specifically for major depression or for bipolar disorders because of these comorbidities. This migraine one, I think, is interesting. Most of these conditions are either mood disorders or they're forms of anxiety, phobia, maybe a little bit less so obsessive compulsive disorder. All of these are manifestations of varying levels of severity and forms of anxiety disorders. So panic disorder is also one of the most highly comorbid, if you look at the difference in the rates, about five times the rates of panic disorder in persons with migraine than without. And interestingly, one of the reasons I showed the divalproate slide, the better tolerated form of valproate, if you look at treatments for migraine, valproate also reduces not the pain of migraine, but the frequency of migraine, and it's an FDA-approved treatment for it. If we look at comparisons between bipolar depression and unipolar depression, bipolar depression tends to start much earlier, be associated with a much stronger family history of depression and to some degree mania, and be associated with more substance abuse, more conduct disorders, and present more of the time. That's my research and my clinical work has increasingly been focused on bipolar disorder, a little less common, but not much less common than major depression, in part because it's easy to study, and in part because it's a highly dysfunctional disorder. Because if we have unipolar depression, we may have one or two episodes lasting untreated 6 or 8 months in the course of a decade. If we have bipolar depression, we're going to be clinically significantly depressed most of the time every year the rest of our lives without treatment. In addition to this earlier age of onset and the higher frequency and the greater proportion of the time ill, there's more in the way of shifting within the bipolar type depression, and more in the way of return to pretty much fully normal levels of function in the person with unipolar depression. If we look at it in terms of symptoms, this should be lability, not liability. There is this greater mood lability. The person with the bipolar disorder is more likely to be slowed down and to report not having any energy. He may really not report sadness, but he simply may report it in terms of an energy kind of problem. If you think about it, if this person goes to the general physician's office, he doesn't think of himself necessarily as depressed, he could be viewed as having dementia, as having anemia, as requiring some kind of general medical workup, because his reports have to do with physical, somatic complaints having to do with other organ systems, not the brain per se. There's some other interesting things that don't so much interfere or lead to viewing the person as having a general medical condition. The insomnia is a bigger problem in unipolar depression than in bipolar depression, and similarly hypersomnia, sleeping excessively long hours or taking long naps during the day, is more associated with bipolar type depression. Most postpartum episodes, whether we call it depression or whether the woman has some delusional psychotic features, are ultimately more linkable to a bipolar type condition than to any other psychiatric disorder. This is just a slide that the two recently published studies of this long-term National Institute of Health funded follow-up of patients with major depression, and in this instance, bipolar disorders. And even though the diagnosis of bipolar conditions is tied to mania or milder forms called hypomania, in fact, patients spend most of their time in depression. So the person with a bipolar II disorder, these groups of bars here, was on average in this very long period of follow-up, 10 years, over half the time these patients had clinically significant depression. Less than 2% of the time did they have clinically significant mild manic symptoms. You can see the problem this poses even for a person who's a specialist such as myself, but even more so if I'm a primary care physician. The person comes in, looks depressed, reports depression. I think he's depressed. I use the antidepressants, not the mood stabilizers, because the ratio of this is about 40-1. He or she doesn't evidence the hypomanic symptoms, and if he does, they may be actually beneficial. He may feel a little bit more alert because he has a little bit more energy. So it's very easy to misdiagnose these patients and go down the wrong treatment path. But even patients whose illness is by definition characterized by having at least one full manic episode, they spend in the yellow much more, about three times as much percentage of the time depressed as they do with any manic symptoms. And it's not that they're fully manic in this 9.3% here. Even if a person has had a full manic episode, most of the time when they are, quote, manic, the phrase we use is hypomanic. They have milder hypomanic symptoms. So they, again, may be so low as to be below the radar screen of the patient, and in some instances, the radar screen of the evaluating clinician. This just shows something about the association of depression with functional impairments. A little bit complex, but the take-home message here is that getting people out of episodes or paying attention to symptoms isn't the only thing that we need to be concerned about. Even if the depression is below the level of what we would call making a diagnosis, these patients function poorly. That this is the mean Hamilton depression score of the better functioning patients is 2.1. The poorer functioning patients in these subsyndromal patients had scores of 6.3. Well, most of you won't be familiar with what this means, but to be in the range that would be associated with a standard diagnosis of depression, it's not a score of 2.1 or 6.3, but around 18 that would qualify. So this is a level of depression, probably on some days you or I would be in this range. But if our patients are in this range all of the time, we're not going to make a diagnosis of depression. If they go to a primary care physician, the primary care physician is likely not to necessarily overlook it, but not to see it as requiring an urgent or definite intervention, and yet the function is substantially impaired. Maybe one or two. Well, this is one of the problems we have in studies of depression. There are lots of studies of depression, but if we move into bipolar depression, if we move into depression in the elderly, you start seeing numbers like this, where yes, there's a nice study that suggests desipramine is more destabilizing, moving patients into manic and hypomanic rates, 5 of 10, than bupropion, but almost regardless of how strong the effect, we're not going to be able to conclude much from studies of just a handful of patients in comparisons. And one of the reasons for that in the elderly is that we tend to find good reasons to want to exclude persons who have kidney diseases or liver diseases or cardiovascular diseases. So the number of patients that we feel comfortable about treating starts to be a lower percentage of all of the patients actually out there. And the kinds of patients that tend to be reported in studies tend not to be generalizable to the complexity, especially that we see in the elderly. But this is just an example that we can, with some treatments. This is, a treatment that was initially approved as an anti-epileptic compound, but it's probably the most impressive medication for treatment of depression in bipolar disorder patients, and possibly, that's under study now, in persons with major depression that doesn't respond to standard treatments. It's not been studied. I can't show you a study of how it looks in the elderly, but I show it in part not just because you see how it clearly outperformed this light bar here is placebo in this 7-week study, about twice the rate of response with 200 milligrams of Lamictal. But if I were to show you the side effect profile of this, it has some side effects. The side effects don't interfere, they don't cause people to have unstable mood. They don't interfere with cognition or alertness, which becomes a substantial issue in the elderly. So knowing differences, even if the rates of response here might not be different, we don't have these comparisons, but I don't think they would, between the Prozacs and the Paxils and the Zolofts of the world, the side effect profile may make them advantageous. And lamotrigine also works not just to treat, but to prevent depression. You give patients a lot of usual care, but no medication in this white line by about 30 weeks, about 25 weeks really, about half have relapsed into depression. If you treat them in the purple here with lamotrigine, less than 1 in 5 relapses, even being followed for 1.5 years. My point about using combination treatments, the same study, however, if we look, and this is a study that also looked at not just lamotrigine, but lithium. Lamotrigine performed better than lithium in this study, without question. But if we look at the patients receiving just one drug who stay in treatment, still doing well at the end of the study, 30%. So one of the reasons we use treatments is not just to make more money for drug companies, it's because medications tend to affect one system or maybe two systems, but the complexities in the brain are such that we often need medications that differ in mechanism and thus have combination treatments. So what we want to do then, I think, is first stabilize a patient, ameliorate the mood symptoms, deal with it in a kind of dimensional fashion. If the patient has psychotic symptoms or serious irritability, we may need a different approach to treatment added to standard antidepressants. We want to do it as rapidly as possible, but also safely. We usually want to establish an approach that continues treatment, not just medication, but any kind of counseling or education beyond the acute phase. And we need to focus on tolerability because tolerability, I think, drives compliance. I think that's the last slide. These are slides I wasn't going to present to you. So, any question before we, are they taking a break again? Yeah. The question is, what is the clinical picture and to make the diagnosis of obsessive compulsive disorder? Obsessive compulsive disorder really gets classed as an anxiety disorder, but I think the evidence is that obsessive compulsive disorder doesn't really fit into this picture that I've showed you about depression and bipolar disorder and anxiety disorders. Obsessive compulsive disorder is not nearly as common. It if we ask people, just do they have any compulsive symptoms, maybe 10% of us would say yes. But what you see with the person with genuine obsessive compulsive disorder is very different. It's a kind of pervasive interference with ordinary stuff. The person may genuinely have notions that are more psychotic than anything else, thinking that if he doesn't perform certain rituals, that he simply can't get through the day. So the person washes their hands to the point that they bleed. There's similar analogous conditions in domestic animals treated by veterinarians. Fairly infrequent, but very difficult to deal with. For example, horses do what's called cribbing, where they will eat, I see someone shaking their head, where they will eat away at the wood in the stalls. Cats will lick themselves to the point that that they bring, actually bleed. And these treatments are the treatments for these are very minimally effective. There's some interesting studies, a hard area to look at, that suggest this may be more a function of structural impairments in the brain associated with use of maybe sub-abusable drugs, maybe infectious agents in the brain. Because unlike the course that I've talked about, where I've defined mood disorders as having, in many instances, for bipolar disorder, an early onset that gets a little bit worse as we move into the senior years of life, and major depression starting maybe a little bit later, but still becoming a little bit more prevalent. Obsessive compulsive disorder, a person can be fully normal until some point in time, and it's as if the sky falls and the bottom drops out. And it's not a widely studied disorder. It may have a different kind of etiology and pathophysiology than these other disorders, even though for reasons of convenience historically, it's gotten grouped in with them. That's a long-winded answer, but I suspect you ask it in part because you've seen someone who has to deal with it, and it's very difficult. It's very strange. One of the slides had in there as one of the treatments electroconvulsive therapy, which is still useful in the small number of patients who don't respond to these much better tolerated, mostly medications. I once treated a person with obsessive compulsive disorder who became depressed and ended up being treated with electroconvulsive therapy. And the electroconvulsive therapy within a week alleviated the depression completely and did not change the obsessive compulsive behavior one iota. Yes?
This may be a bit unrelated, but do you know any estimates of the prevalence of hoarding among
the elderly? Of what?
Hoarding. The prevalence of that?
But certainly hoarding is not uncommon. Think of hoarding, though, as an extension of some of the symptoms associated with dementia. I don't think that we would see it really as a function of obsessive compulsive disorder or of mood disorders. So it has the look of a psychological disorder, and is, but usually it's a function of this more internal focus of the person unable to orient himself to all that's really going on outside in relationship to dementia of one form or another. So the approach to hoarding, I think, is more environmental, and to more link this as a symptom, a fairly severe, actually, dementia form conditions. I would think, though, that if, and there are some data on this, I don't have them in this slide set and don't work with dementia unless it shows up in the context of mood disorders, it would be less common than agitation, it would be less common than irritability and hostility, but it still would be fairly common. If you looked at a group of unequivocally Alzheimer's dementia diagnosed patients, you'd probably see 10-15% of patients with some degree of hoarding. It's often the kind of thing that escapes detection because the person is not going to tell you, I put my driver's license in such and such a drawer. He's trying to make sure that you don't know that he's, or if he can think that through. So it requires vigilance on the part of caretakers, back to this point that this one of the slides made about caretaker burden and dealing with the elderly. Thanks very much.
One pill makes you